Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Mr. Chairman, my dear colleagues. I will present now a subject which I hope it's interesting also and applicable and promising in the treatment of diabetes. Our agenda today will be a rapid introduction about the role of beta cell function, the new classification of diabetes by WHO in 2019, and the lessons and the hope which we can get from remission phase of type 1 diabetes. I think all of us agree that diabetes is one of the fastest increasing disease worldwide, isn't it? And in spite of the considerable improvement in treatment, new drugs, still diabetes is a progressive disease, and we cannot stop complications of disease. One explanation for these shortcomings is that our management in diabetes only focusing on one metabolite, which is the blood glucose, measurement of one metabolite blood glucose. But we are not addressing the primary pathogenesis of diabetes. And because of this, in 2016, in diabetes care, it's written that it is a time for a new classification for diabetes. And they put a rationale and implication of the beta cell-centric classification of diabetes. The beta cell-centric model presupposes that all diabetes originates from a final common denominator, which is the abnormal pancreatic beta cell. Whatever the pathogenesis of diabetes, the common denominator, the final step, will be an abnormal beta cell. And they said whatever the predisposing factor, either the genetic, environmental, inflammation, immune regulation, insulin resistance, all these factors will act on the beta cell to affect the secretion or cause destruction. And at that time, diabetes starts. And we are, as we're discussing now, the egregious 11 factors, 11 pathogenesis, and more could be discovered later on about the pathogenesis of diabetes. More and more drugs are elaborated in the market, but still, nothing is targeting the beta cell itself. And because of this, in 2019, by WHO, it said that it's now agreed that the underlying characteristic common to all forms of diabetes is the dysfunction or the destruction of the beta cell. And they said that the previous classification of diabetes, type 1, type 2, gestational, sometimes put the clinician into a conflict. You can be confronted with the patient. You cannot put it in a type 1 or type 2. And at that time, you are in a dilemma, how to treat these patients. And they said that we are looking for a classification which helps the health professionals to choose appropriate treatment. When you are firstly encountered by the patient, this patient needs insulin or doesn't need insulin. And they put a new classification. They said that some patients need, there are classic type 1, and some patients are classic type 2, but still there are hybrid forms of diabetes, like the slowly evolving immune-mediated diabetes or the ketosis-prone type 2 diabetes, which we discussed now. And there are other specific types, like the monogenic diabetes, the monogenic defects of beta cell function, or the monogenic defect in insulin action. And at the end, still, you can be confronted with the patient, which you will put at the end as an unclassified diabetes. The hybrid forms of diabetes, the slowly evolving immune-mediated diabetes, which was called before as LADA, this group of people does not require insulin therapy at diagnosis. They are initially controlled with lifestyle plus or minus oral agents, but progress rapidly to require insulin. So what are the difference from type 2? There is auto antibody against glutamic acid decarboxylase. And this type also you can be confronted in the youth, not only in the adult. The other form, which is the ketosis-prone type 2 diabetes, was discovered over the past 15 years in young African Americans. Typically, those affected present with ketosis and evidence of severe insulin deficiency, a florid presentation of diabetes, but later go into remission and don't require insulin at all. The actual pathogenesis is unclear still until now. No genetic markers could be found, no autoantibodies could be found. You are confronted with a patient who presents with florid diabetes, need insulin sometimes, after sometimes, the patient go into remission and no need for insulin. The monogenic diabetes also, due to the advances in the genetic testing, we have many types of monogenic diabetes, either the monogenic defect of beta cell, which are three, maturity onset diabetes of the young Moody, and neonatal diabetes, either permanent or transient. What's interesting in this disease is that Moody is a dominantly inherited early onset familial diabetes that is not dependent on insulin and results from beta cell dysfunction. Glucokinase Moody results in lifelong mild fasting hyperglycemia that deteriorates little with age. And in spite of presentation in young age, these patients only, they have only lifelong mild fasting hyperglycemia and not for treatment at all. And the hepatocellular nuclear factor 1 alpha Moody, which is the commonest form of Moody, result in progressive and marked hyperglycemia with high risk of vascular complication, but these patients are sensitive to sulfonylurea. The monogenic defects in insulin are less common. This patient presents with feature of insulin resistance, like the hyperinsulinemia, acanthosis nigricans, polycystic ovarian disease, and virilization, but these patients are not obese. So the typical presentation of type 1 and type 2, they are not present many times in our patients. And we can see here that the GCK, as we said, the glucokinase Moody, no treatment at all is needed. For Moody, hepatocellular nuclear factor 1 alpha, only sulfonylurea is effective, no need for insulin. So in fronting the patient with diabetes, you have to think about the status of the beta cell itself. Is it function or not functioning? What is the level of destruction of beta cell? What about the remission of type 1 diabetes? Actually, the remission of type 1 diabetes is particularly a very interesting stage, the natural rates of diabetes. Because sometimes you are asked by your patient, is diabetes a curable disease? Can I be cured from diabetes? And of course, our answer is no. Diabetes is not a curable disease. But actually, the spontaneous remission phase of diabetes is a natural model of cure from diabetes. The patient, after the child, after presenting with florid diabetes, go into remission and doesn't need insulin or very small dose of insulin. And they said it's believed that these patients could regain beta cell mass during the partial remission phase, followed by increase in the endogenous insulin secretion. And as we said, the remission phase provides a natural model of islet cell function recovery. And it's a hope for our patients if we understand more and more about this, how to protect the beta cells from destruction, we can have a cure at one day from diabetes. The definition of remission phase actually is different in different studies. Sometimes depending on the beta cell function, the C-peptide, sometimes depending on the dose of insulin, low dose, less than 0.5 unit per kg per day, in presence of satisfactory A1C like 7%, or a calculated insulin dose adjusted A1C, which is more practical, and you can make it, you can calculate it in your clinic. It's calculated by adding A1C plus 4 times the insulin dose in unit per kg per day. If it's less or equal to 9, this patient is in remission phase. In discussing the mechanisms of this remission phase, we have either immunological or metabolic mechanisms. Immunological mechanism, what's interesting is the immunological tolerance to beta cell autoantigens. Yani, at the start of the disease, there is destruction of beta cell because there is antigen-antibody interaction. But there may be a tolerance of these beta cells to the antibody. There is no destruction of the beta cell by this antigen. And there may be a recovery of beta cell function or beta cell regeneration in addition to the satisfactory metabolic control. The immune mechanism was found that there is high interleukin-10 expression in peripheral blood mononuclear cells and low serum interferon gamma secretion in people in remission phase, which means there is autoimmune dysregulation. The immunological molecules, it's shown that in the non-obese diabetes mice study, blood stem cells expressing more programmed cell death 1 molecule could effectively inhibit the autoimmune T cell response. The immune cells, it's believed that the homeostasis between the regulatory, which is protective T cell, and the effector, which is the destructive T cells, plays an important role in regulating the immunological tolerance or destruction. Furthermore, some of the immunomodulators like rituximab and abatacept was found to prolong the partial remission phase. In brief, all these altogether, these results demonstrate that different immune cells are strongly involved in the pathogenesis of the remission phase of diabetes. These are some of the new studies in 2019 and 2020 about the remission phase. This study discussed the five dimensions of beta cell tolerance, and this group discussed that in our understanding of immune reaction, we are usually looking at antigen antibody like a key and lock. This antibody is a key of this lock. But they said sometimes there is a fourth dimension and fifth dimension. And they said that sometimes some people, they have autoantibodies and still they don't develop disease. Like what? Like rheumatoid factor and anti-double strand DNA. They have autoantibodies but don't develop disease. Why? Because they said the time of creation of these antibodies and the localization may prevent the destruction of the cell. And even there's another dimension, which is the accommodation of the target cells. After being destructed, some cells are destructed, they can have a repair and resistance. And the understanding more and more about this can reach a point that we can protect our beta cells. Another study mentioned that proliferating beta cells control immune tolerance in autoimmune diabetes. They found in this model the non-obese diabetic mice, the cytotoxic T cell in red, a lot of cytotoxic T cell causing death. This in gray, this beta cells dead in gray, and quiescent beta cells in yellow, and there is no insulin. On the other hand, in the other model, the non-obese diabetic mice with the liver insulin receptor knockout, they delete the gene of liver insulin receptors. They have proliferation of beta cells with a lot of protective T cells in blue, less cytotoxic T cell in red, and a lot of insulin, as you see. In 2020, just a few months ago, they studied the glutamic acid decarboxylase aluminum hydroxide immunotherapy in type 2 diabetes. And this is actually a human study, not an animal study. And they found interesting finding that this expands a bifunctional T helper 1 and T helper 2 autoreactive CD4 T cells, and they have both destruction and both protection. Another point in the endogenous pancreatic beta cell regeneration, in spite of doing transplantation, we can induce regeneration of beta cells from the existing beta cell or non-beta cell pancreatic cells of the patient. And they mentioned actually a lot of protocols, complex protocols, it's not our scope, that are sometimes helpful in regenerating beta cells. At the end, the interaction between immunity and metabolism, they say that in vitro studies show that activated T cells, which are the immunological cells, express glucose transporter 1, which activates the expression of the molecules. Again, a glucose energy supply is necessary for beta cell to maintain growth proliferation. In brief, the immune function of beta cell actually depends on glucose metabolism, the interaction between metabolism and immunity. What I want to say, in summary, that beta cell is actually the end point and the main point in the pathogenesis of diabetes. When you are confronted with your patient, think about the status of the beta cell. Does the patient need insulin or no? Don't put yourself in a box. This patient is type 1 or type 2. No. Be broad-minded about the diagnosis. And of course, the fully understanding the mechanisms underlying the intersection of metabolism and immunology can help to reach a day that we can improve management and prognosis of patients of diabetes. And thank you very much.